Hallelujah. Father, today we thank and praise you for the opportunity we have to give, to tithe, to sow, an opportunity to take part in your economic system. Thank you, Father, that we're not bound by what's going on in the world system. We're not in fear of ever running out. We're in faith for running over because you said you'll make us rich in every way. You said, Father, you'll make all grace abound toward us so that we will always, on every occasion, have sufficiency in all things and abound to every good work. So I pray now that as each person has given according to their, according to what's purpose in their hearts and given the tithe according to how you've increased them, that, Lord, you bless us according to your word, and that, Father, we continue to be a light and example in this dark world of people who are not in that system, but we are depending and trusting in you and seeing the fruit of it, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. All right. Praise the Lord today. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. It is our season to be blessed. It is our season to increase and to prosper. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. In fact, we're in a harvest season right now.
Yes.
Sister Bashir mentioned about us synchronizing with God. We're coming to the close of one season, of one year, into the opening of a new year, if you understand God's calendar. And September 24th is Rosh Hashanah, which Rosh Hashanah means head of the year. And so what happens is we're closing one and entering to another one. And first fruits always comes in a new year season. That all comes later on. But that means that there's a harvest in the end of the old season. So you ought to be really cognizant, really aware, really in expectation of great harvest right now. You understand that? You ought to really be swinging your sickle real hard, fast and often, because it's a harvest time. And so it's your season to be blessed.
Yes.
That stands very true to this morning. Amen?
Amen.
And so I just wanted to just make sure y'all know that and be ready to be blessed today. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Well, welcome to Exceeding Grace. Good to see y'all here this morning.
Amen.
Let's open our Bibles.
Yes.
Let's open our Bibles, get into the Word of God this morning. I want to say welcome to all of our guests and good to have y'all with us today at Exceeding Grace. You know, we're kind of strange by city standards, by world standards, because we just believe the Bible to be true. And it's not just words on a page. It's a life to us. Y'all agree with that? It's life to us. Hallelujah. Open to Psalm number 78. Go back and finish what we began last week. Psalm number 78. Glory to God. We're going to read verses 1 through 8. You'll have that?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's read together, please. Everybody together with us. Let's all stand. Let's do that. I think if you have two legs and two feet, you can stand. You know that whole thing we said about in your honor?
Honor.
It's honoring God. That's why we do it. Not just form of fashion. It's a matter of honoring God and honoring his word. Amen. I'll get three amens by the time I'm done. It's a matter of honoring God and honoring his word. If Queen Elizabeth walked in, they'd mandate. If President Obama walked in, they'd mandate that you stand. So when the king is here, we're going to read his word. It's just a matter of us standing in honor of God. Amen. All right, Psalm number 78, verses 1 through 8. Let's read that together. Ready, read. Give ear, O my people, to my law. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, telling to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. For he has established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers, that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them, the children who would be born, that they may arise and declare them to their children, that they may set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments, and may not be like their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that did not set its heart aright and whose spirit was not faithful to God. Father, today we thank and praise you for the word. We ask that God, you speak to us. We are servants. We are ready to hear. We are willing to obey and do what you say today. So Father, speak to us by your spirit, spirit to spirit today, God. And God, whatever is wrong, make it right. And we pray, Father, that you would not only change us, but through us, a generation will be changed and saved to the glory of God, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right, take your seats today in the presence of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. We're continuing what we began last week. We began a message last Sunday entitled Changing a Generation. Changing a Generation. And we got, you know, sort of excited with that and dealing with holiness and righteousness and how we ought to be. And I realized again how old school I am.
Yeah.
Amen. That I'm really, a young man in old school body.
Yes.
Or an old school man in a young man's body, or however you want to put it. I shared with y'all Wednesday night, I applied to new school, but they wouldn't take me. They said I was too old school. But I think, the Bible says that we should remove the landmarks which our fathers have set, that we should go with the ancient landmarks. There are things that are set for us that we need to make sure we abide by and not be so postmodern, not be so trying to be so culturally relevant that we become irreverent to God and irreverent to the Word of God. Uh-huh. I know this is not exciting already. But what's happened in church, the body of Christ has tried to become so culturally relevant that we've become irreverent to God.
Come on!
To the point where it almost would seem as if in our minds, God really doesn't exist. That he's become a fairy tale, that he's become just some mythological person like Zeus and like Thor and like those Greek gods that we learned about in school. But God is real and God is alive. Hallelujah. And godliness means to have a keen awareness of God's presence and of his reality, not a form of godliness. When you have only a form of godliness, the Bible says you deny the power thereof. So there is a power that goes with the godliness.
Amen.
Glory to God. I better start my clock before I get carried away. There's a power that goes with godliness. And the reason why we've not seen widespread the power of God demonstrated in the church as we should or in our lives as we should is because we have resorted to only a form of godliness. Well, I come to church because it's Sunday. That's a form of godliness. I go to, I read because, I try to find something for my problem. That's a form of godliness. But when we don't have a real relationship, which means I'm aware that God is alive and God is real, and I have a relationship with him, a fellowship with him every day, if I don't have that, then I don't have true godliness. And if I don't have true godliness, then I deny the power that comes from that godliness and then wonder why my life seems so blah or it seems as if I can't get victories all the time. You and I are meant to have and enjoy victories all the time. Hallelujah. So when I'm saying I'm old school, I'm not apologizing about that. I'm just making you aware of it. I said, I'm not apologizing about that. I'm just making you aware of it. Amen? Hallelujah. Now, God is concerned, and we said this last week, about not only individuals and families, but he's concerned about entire generations. Whenever you hear God speaking about the past and present and future, you'll hear him speak in terms of entire generations, because God looks, when he assesses a time or a people, he assesses the spiritual climate and the spiritual condition within certain generations.
Right.
That there, he'll speak of during this generation, he was worshipped. Or during this generation, we read this in fact last week from Judges, that there arose a generation that did not know the Lord. Because God always speaks and assesses the climate or the condition of entire generation. And over in Psalm 95, verse 10, you don't have to turn there. It'll get on the screen. Just write this down if you want. If you're taking notes. But in Psalm 95, verse 10, God said, for 40 years, I was grieved with that generation. So there's a generation he was talking about in the past, and he says, I was grieved with that generation. Now, you and I know in that generation that he's talking about the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, right? 40 years they wandered around, having left Egypt, should have been in their Canaan land within 11 days. But 40 years, because of their unbelief, because of their disobedience, they wandered around 40 years. And in the midst of that generation, there was Joshua, there was Caleb, and those guys who served God. But in God's eyes, he said, I was grieved with that generation. Because he speaks of a generational climate, of a generational condition. And he said, it is a people who go astray in their hearts, and they do not know my ways. Sound like we're repeating history. In present terms, he always speaks of generation. Genesis 7, verse 1, we read this one last week. Genesis 7, verse 1, said, then the Lord said to Noah, come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. So God was looking at present time, talking to Noah back in Genesis 7, and he says, in this generation, which apparently must have been pretty evil. We know that in Noah's time, it was an evil day. But he said, Noah, you stand out to me. You stand out, but still this generation is evil. So though there may be standouts, the generation was called evil. All right, Psalm 102, verse 18. Psalm 102, verse 18. This will be written for the generation to come. Are you seeing past, present, and future? There's the only reason to take you through these scriptures here so you see that God spoke of generations past. He would speak to a present generation. Then he says, for the generation to come, that a people yet to be created may praise the Lord. So he said he's looking forward. The psalmist here is saying, we're looking forward to there's a coming generation. Not a few handful. Not a few folk. Not even just a remnant. And I know in the church we speak so much about a remnant. And I believe God has a remnant. But the remnant is... the remnant is a seed. And the Bible says another place in Psalms, it says that a seed would serve him and it shall be accounted to him for a generation. Boy, y'all are psyched. So thank God for being part of the remnant. How many of y'all believe we're part of the remnant? Do you understand what I mean when I say a remnant? In other words, not everybody's gone the way of evil. Not everybody's walking the way of the wicked. Some of us are, you know what, I'm going to serve God. Some of y'all might even say, you know what, Pastor, I'm a little bit old school myself. I don't get all this newfangled stuff. I'm still old school. I believe holiness is right. I believe we got to walk right. I believe we got to live right. I believe we got to talk right. I believe there's a way. I believe God has standards. God has commandments. God has rules, and they're not burdensome. They're not grievous. I'm not upset with God's rules. I don't think God's trying to control me. I know God's trying to bless me and prosper me, and I receive what he has to say. If so, if that's you, you're old school. Because new school Christians think I can live any way I want, do what I want, and I'm okay. Just want to make it to heaven. Just want to make it in. No, I don't just want to make it to heaven. Because the New Testament talks about us not being ashamed at his coming. God, hallelujah. So in other words, when Jesus Christ cracks the sky, I tell you that, he is going to crack that sky. In other words, he is coming. He is coming. When he cracks the sky, then we're supposed to see him, the Bible says, in perfect peace. But if your heart's not right with God, you've not been walking with God, then when you see him, you'll be ashamed at his coming. And I don't want God, I don't want Jesus Christ to come back, crack the sky, and I go hiding. I go in the shame mode. See, I'm still old school. And I don't want to have hidden things, because you know, you got to, the Bible says every man got to stand before God to give an account of the deeds done in his body, whether they be good or bad. Everybody has to give an account. And I don't want God pulling out my account and finding all kind of stuff in there. Now, there are things that were there, but they're forgiven. Now, see, some of y'all, your neighbors didn't clap because they don't know this stuff. There was... Oh, there was stuff that was there. Now, don't get it bent. There was stuff that was there, but it's been forgiven. Now, once it's been forgiven and I've been washed, I don't want to go back to it. But a lot of folk don't have an old school mindset. They think you can, you know, it doesn't matter. Just, you know, if you go back, God will forgive you every time. No, you can't just keep sinning willfully. I'm old school now. I'm warning you. You can't sin willfully and keep leaning on God to forgive you. That's not, tell your neighbor, that's not how this works. Tell them that's not how any of this works. You got to walk right. You got to live right. You got to serve God with all your heart. Hallelujah. God will have to unfriend you. Praise the Lord. Now turn over to Matthew 13 for me, please. Matthew 13. Hallelujah. I hope to raise up some old school Christians. We got a few in here, don't we? No, it's not everybody. I know everybody here ain't old school. Y'all got quiet. Y'all like the disciples around the communion table. Lord, is it me? Is it me? That's what Jesus said, one of y'all gonna betray me. They was like, is it me? And you should know if it's you or not. This... But they all asking, Lord, is it me? Am I gonna betray you? Yeah, that's all you should have said. It ain't me. Should have been saying, is it you? Isn't it funny? Nobody asked, is it you? They all said, is it me? Hallelujah. If you don't know yourself by now, good gracious. Hallelujah. But I have no plans of turning back. Amen. Matthew 12 and verse 38. I want to show you something here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Verse 38. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered, saying, Teacher, we want to see a sign from you. But he answered and said to them, an evil and adulterous generation. Not person, not group, not church, a generation. He's indicting the whole generation. He says, seeks after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it or to this generation except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was in, y'all remember Jonah?
Yes.
Remember Jonah? Jonah was the one. He wasn't in jail. Jonah didn't build the ark. Okay, I'm gonna make sure. We miss these, some of these Bible stories. Amen. If I was some of y'all, you know, you're a new believer, might just have to go to the store and buy your children's Bible story book. Nothing wrong with that. Learn these Bible stories, amen, because I don't have time to review all the Bible stories every Sunday. Amen. Need to learn David slayed the giant, amen? Amen. All right, so Jonah was the one who was on the ship, this is review, on the ship, on the wrong ship, going the wrong direction. God had told him, I want you to go down to Nineveh. He said, uh-uh. He said, I ain't doing that. Because he didn't like the Ninevites. God wanted to save the Ninevites. Wanted him to tell them to repent because he was going to destroy them. But he said, if they repent, I'll save them. And Jonah's like, I ain't doing that. I can't stand them folk. You know how y'all say your neighbor, I can't stand them folks. He said, I can't stand them folk. And so he got on the wrong ship, headed to Tarshish. Wrong ship, wrong direction. And what happened, a storm came and begin to beat that ship up, and everybody in the ship was about to lose their life. And they had to find out which one of y'all on this ship don't belong on this ship. See, let me tell you something. Thank you, Lord. I might as well stay since I'm here. If you get in the wrong direction on the wrong ship, you'll mess other folk lives up. Because you hard-headed. Got it? And so they finally figured out who this was that's causing this disturbance on our ship. And all those folk who, you know, even though he paid his fare, they threw him overboard. Threw him overboard, and the God had, you know, through his grace, had divinely arranged for a large fish, a great fish, to come and to rescue him. All right? Jonah and the whale. We don't know whether there was a whale. They say, what's a whale? We don't know, because the Bible never said whale. It just said a great fish. All right? But let's assume it was a whale for the storybook's sake. So this whale catches him, and he's 3 days, 3 nights in the belly of that whale. He finally repents and says, all right, God, I'll do what you said. Lost all his hair, everything, just all this kind of stuff happens to him. And he finally repents and gets on the right road, going the right way. Got it? So if you find yourself in the belly of the whale, you might need to repent and say, Lord, I need to get on the right road, going the right direction. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Or he went down into hell.
Right.
It's after his crucifixion. He wasn't just sleeping for 3 days. He went down into the belly of the earth, the heart of the earth. Then in verse 41 says, the men of Nineveh, watch this, will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it. He's talking to the present generation. And he says, the men of Nineveh will rise up and condemn it, this generation. Why? Because at least, we can throw in the words, at least, they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And indeed, what does it say? A greater than Jonah is here. So you have me now here, greater than Jonah preaching to you, and what he's implying is you won't even repent. He says, so that nation who did repent, they're going to rise up and condemn. Oh, there ain't no more condemnation. Now listen, that's people in the world, in the body of Christ. There ain't no more condemnation. He's saying this nation, this Nineveh, going to rise up and condemn those that don't repent. All right, he goes on to say, the queen of the south, or we might know the queen of Sheba, will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And indeed, what? A greater than Solomon is here. You remember the queen of Sheba? You read over in 2 Chronicles, she came with this after Solomon became king and God blessed him, made him wise, and made him rich beyond natural understanding. The queen of Sheba came and she fainted when she saw everything this man had that God had blessed him with. Now, she came to hear his wisdom. She recognized, here I am, I'm a queen, I have a government, but his is better, greater than mine. I've got a system, but his system is working better than mine. So she said, I got to go and get and learn something from him. Got it? So the point is, Jesus is saying, and a greater than Solomon is here. So he's saying this generation should at least been wise enough to see there's something I have that you all don't have. And you should come and see me. But no, instead of coming to see me, they're looking, trying to critique me. They're looking for a sign. They're looking for something. Do one of them tricks you do, Jesus. This is what they're saying here. Now, what does that mean to us? Well, to us, that in today, we have the cross. We have the blood. We have the word in print. They didn't have this stuff. They didn't have the cross. They didn't have the blood. They didn't have the word. They didn't have the Holy Ghost. Now we have all these and won't repent. Won't seek his face, seek his wisdom. He says, and when you have that in a generation, generations that were past will rise up and condemn or judge a generation because at least they had enough sense to repent. Hallelujah. So we have a generation that now in the world and to some degree even the church that's not convinced of the lordship of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
I like it quiet. Because in the world, they mock Jesus. Come on, don't they mock Jesus right now to this day? You turn on television, you turn on anything, they mock Jesus. They won't say anything about Buddha. They won't say anything about Muhammad when they mock Jesus. Right? They don't want Jesus Christ in the school. They don't want him in the government. They don't want him in business. They don't want him in any arena in society. They don't receive Jesus Christ. Now that he's a nice guy, he's a prophet, he's a teacher, but they don't know that he's Lord. So they don't know one day every knee's gonna bow. And every tongue's gonna confess that not that he's a teacher, not that he was a good prophet, not that he was a good man. But that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. See, he's Lord whether they like it or not. He's Lord whether they know it or not. And Lord means he's master, which means it's his way.
Yes, sir.
It's his, y'all got, it's his way. And now I said to you that even to some degree, the church still doesn't understand that. Because men in the church are still trying to, I heard somebody say it on the radio this morning, trying to straddle the fence. That's the word they use in my dad's time, straddling the fence. Now, you can be on one side of the fence and you can move along real good, other side you move along, but when you straddle the fence, it's probably going to hurt a little bit. It's going to hurt. And you can't move when you're straddling the fence. And the devil doesn't mind people straddling the fence. Oh, go on to church. I'll see you at about 12. Then we go do our thing. Go on there, you know, because your grandma done went to church. You know you just got to go to church. The devil's found that. Just go on to church. Go ahead and put your little time in. I'm messing with two or three people in here. Just go and put your little time in. Just, you know, we'll hang out later. The devil's like, I know you got to do your church thing. Keep up the hypocrisy.
Yeah. Come on.
You can do that. I'm going to see you later on. What happens is people have accepted Jesus Christ as he's my Savior. He's my Savior. He saved me. He saved me. But we must confess him as Lord. In that Romans 10 verse 9? That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, not confess the Savior Jesus, confess the Lord Jesus. Well, Pastor, why you mess with this? Because Lord means he runs the show. Am I talking to anybody in the back? Am I talking to any young people in here? Any kids, y'all understand what I'm saying to you? Any grown folks understand what I'm saying to you? I don't have to pull my ear, do I? I don't have to, you know. Lord means he runs the show. Lord means I don't really have an opinion. I don't want one. Lord means it's not how I feel. Well, I feel, yeah, but I feel. No, in lordship, it's not about how I feel. It's about what the Lord said. And the body of Christ is in this generation, impotent, ineffective, unattractive. Because it all goes back to the root that he's not Lord. Because if we made him Lord, then power comes out of lordship. Power comes out of lordship. Because when I make him Lord, and thank you, Lord. That's what happened when that one man came to Jesus Christ and said, hey, sir, could you heal my servant? And Jesus said, sure, I'll come and heal him. He said, no, you don't need to come heal him. You don't need to come. He said, just send the word. Remember the story here? He said this to Jesus, this is a centurion. He said, just send the word and my servant will be healed. Right? Now, he said, because this is a centurion, I know how this works. He said, because I'm a man in authority and I'm a man under authority. And when I say to a man, go, he goes. And when I say to a man, come, he comes. Because I'm a man in authority and I'm a man under authority. So what he's saying is that the reason I have power is because I'm under power. The reason I have authority is because I'm under authority. The reason I can be a Lord is because I'm under a Lord. And when you and I as believers get under the Lordship of Jesus Christ, now we become lords over sickness and lords over disease and lords over debt and lords over lack. And power comes from lordship. You know why Jesus Christ is able to function so well? He said, because I only do, he said, my Father's always with me because I only do those things that he tells me to do. Hallelujah. He said, my Father's always with me because I always do the things he tells me to do. Right. What? Well, God's always with everybody. No. That's not what he said. He didn't mean just God's omnipresence. He means the reason why God's power always worked in his life was because I always did what he told me to do. I'm preaching for 16 of y'all. Yes. If you want to see God's power functioning in your life, you've got to stop doing whatever the world you want to do. Just because I feel like this, or I don't feel like this, or just because I want to, or I don't want to. It ain't what you, Gershon, when you were in the Marines, man, you wanted to smile because you were thinking stuff. You can't, don't smile on this. Now, you would think there should have been nothing wrong with him smiling. Oh, this ain't the line for smiling. Come on, move on, Pastor. See? All right. Praise God. Lordship of Jesus Christ. Everybody say, he's my Lord.
He's my Lord.
Not just my Savior.
Not just my Savior.
See, when he's Lord, I do what he tells me to do. I consider him. Before I move, I consider him. What does he say about this? See, I know this is true because, you know, the body of Christ, we don't vote like it. Y'all say, uh-oh. We don't vote like it. We vote based on color. We vote based on party. We vote based on how our grandmama voted, and we vote based on that. We don't vote based on his lordship. My wife will tell you, I sat there this last, y'all know we just had a primary, right? Another election coming up here in November, right? And I vote by mail. And I don't waste time going into the ballot box. That's, it takes too much of my time. My time's too important to do that. Since they allow us to do it by mail. Now, if we couldn't do it by mail, then I'd give my time to that. But since we can do our mail, I don't give them my time. I just give them the vote. My wife would tell you that I'll sit there and take hours. I look over the whole ballot. I don't just go Democrat, 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 or Republican, Republican, Republican. I see that person's name, what they're running for, and I Google it. What do you stand for? What do you believe? What are you saying? What are you doing? See, I don't just give away votes. See, most of y'all, you ain't, don't lie to me. You go in the ballot box just because you're trying to hurry up. You just check. You use Christmas tree ballots because, you know, I got to do this. I got to fill out something. I just got to fill out something. Hello, it's quiet here at 11:47. See, but lordship means, wait a minute, I got to consider. What does my Lord say? So I'll sit there and I'll get all the information and I'll say, all right, Holy Spirit. Tell me who to vote for. Why? He's my Lord. See, y'all think I'm just crazy and radical. Pastor, you go too far. I don't think I go far enough. All right. Let's look at Psalm 78. Thank you, Jesus. I want power in my life. I want power in my life. I want power so that when my children come to me coughing, Dad, I'm back, I'm sick. Let me lay hands on you and you get healed. No time for that stuff. I want power when the devil tries to bring disruption and confusion to my house. Yes. I command peace and peace shows up.
Hallelujah.
Yes. I don't have time for anything different. I need to have power every day of my life. We need power in this generation today. Amen.
Yes.
Now we looked at this last week how the writer Asaph was contemplating the state of affairs for the particular generation he was in. He was looking over some past generations and their plight, and then looking forward to what was going to come in the generations that were coming in the future. All right? Now, in doing so, we saw he began to recall, again, what was happening back before. Now, without going on reviewing that, I want to jump right into this today because I want to give you a few pointers here. All right. In Psalm 78, rather, verse 2 through 4, Asaph says, I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. Now, what he's giving us a clue here is how to affect or how to change the generation to come. Now, he's saying, I'm going to open my mouth, which means I'm going to say something. All right, and we dealt with that last week, how you and I got to start saying something.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We can't be silent anymore.
Right.
Silent and just wagging our heads. Silent and just judging people from a distance.
Right.
Silent and then just condemning people from a distance.
Yes, right.
No. Say something. And we're silent because we're afraid or we're apathetic. What I mean by that? Afraid, well, what are they going to say to me? Or apathetic as in, well, I don't really care. What's that got to do with me? Or that's none of my business. But God is looking at a whole generation. Are y'all saying this here today? Are you seeing God evaluates whole entire generations? I mean, most of us know in the natural, we know about the baby boomers. That generation. How many of y'all are in baby boomers? You know that in baby boomers. How many of y'all know what generation you're in? How many of y'all don't know? That's a better question. How many of you don't know? All right. All right, baby boomers. There's the Buster generation. That's the generation I'm in. Born around 1970, between 1970 and 1990 or so. We're in the children. Yeah, the privileged children. But ironically, they gave us the name the Busters. Now, what's interesting about that is that. The boomers came out of a generation. Their parents taught them something. They instilled some things in them. But all of a sudden, when everybody began to become more affluent, to whatever degree you became, your parents or grandparents became affluent, the more affluent people became, the less geared people were towards the things of God. And work, ethic. I'm just saying it. And more, we became more of a, and what happened after the Busters, is you develop a you owe me generation. An entitlement generation. That's just where we are today. All right. So we're again, people assess a whole generation. So, you know, you say those 20-somethings or those 40-somethings. So in other words, we do it in the natural. So in the spirit, the same thing is happening by God, that God looks on a whole generation. So to say, well, that's none of my business. Yes, it is your business. See, what generation was it that let prayer leave schools? What generation was it that didn't fight for the Ten Commandments? What generation was it that said, okay, gay marriage is right? What generation said abortion is right? What? See, there's, God's going to judge a generation about that. He's going to judge. See, we think, well, it just doesn't matter. No. God's looking at a whole generation. Which generation was it that didn't teach their kids to work? Which generation created all these sorry men? Which? See, God got to look at all that. Because God looks at a generation. Now, again, we already know this. There will be standouts. There will be standouts in every generation. There will be some people, that remnant, who say, oh, no, I'm not like, I understand hard work, and I understand what it is to say, you know, I understand, you know, effort. I understand, you know, so on and so forth. But just because I got it doesn't mean, I say, well, I don't care what happens to generation. No. Every generation, because they said, he said, Nineveh will rise up and judge a generation. Queen of the South will judge a generation. Hallelujah. So let's get into this here. So Asaph says, I got to open my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. He said, we won't hide them from our children. Tell unto the generation to come the praises of the Lord and what his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. All right? Now, so I got to open my mouth. I've got to say something. I've got to tell the generation to come the praises of the Lord. Hallelujah. And the things he's done. We talked about that last Sunday, how each in children of Israel coming out of Egypt, going into the promised land, every step of the way he had them build a memorial. Even once they got into the promised land, even in Samuel's day, they had to erect memorials. Whatever victories that God gave them, they put up memorials. Mm-hmm. Every victory, they marked it. Just thought came to my mind just now about that's exactly what Islam does. Mm-hmm. Islam, every... Y'all like, what are you about to say? Every victory they gain, they build, they erect something. That's why immediately after 9/11, in 2001, they immediately sought to erect, to put a mosque there right on the site. You search every major place where they've struck through history. They go and put a mosque somewhere as a note, we conquered this area. It's a memorial.
Oh, no, it's friendly.
Yeah, America just goes, this is just friendly. No, it's not friendly.
No.
Oh, God. Are y'all watching this whole thing with ISIS currently?
Oh, yes.
Anybody watching this, seeing what's going on with ISIS? Where they're, you know, this militant Islamic group, extremist Islamic group, and they're launching this war against the West. And they've now, on video, beheaded three guys, and there are more to come. They already told it. And it was so funny. I was on the radio this morning, and this guy, it was a preacher, and he was saying, he was saying, well, you know, people are saying this is what Islam does. And he said, no, this is not Islam. This is ISIS. He said, because Islam is a religion of peace. And I thought, you're ignorant. I know I'm off topic. He said, Islam is a religion of peace. I'm like, well, what Quran have you read? Because the Quran is laced with blood. It is a religion of war. Islam is a religion of war. It is a religion of death. And their ultimatum is join us or die. Infidels, join us or die. That's why they're doing what they're doing. They don't care about getting land. They don't care about oil. It's religious. And our administration thinks they can fight this in a regular way. This religious. It's a spiritual thing. But they're trying to be politically direct. Well, you can't discriminate against the Muslims coming into our country because they want freedom. Maybe 10% of them. But they're coming to occupy. Oh, y'all don't care nothing about this. See, y'all don't care nothing about this, but y'all understand this is dealing with a generation.
Yes, sir.
It's dealing with a generation. It's dealing with people trying to spread their dogma through a generation. So they immediately go for the youth. That's why the ISIS organization, which is fighting against America and the West, is filled with Americans. Fighting against our own nation. Why? Because it's generational. They're trying to get to a generation. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. So Asaph said, I gotta open my mouth. I gotta open my mouth. Utter dark sayings of old. I gotta speak in parables. I gotta tell you what the fathers know. I gotta tell you the works of God, because if not, you'll start trying to have ecumenical services with the Islams, with the Muslims. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. I can set it down, because see y'all like, see this, because I'm telling you what's happening in the church. Now we're gonna have interfaith services. We all have our ecumenical interfaith services where all the Christians and all the Muslims and all the Baha'i and all the folk get together, and we're gonna have everybody got their little symbol on the bumper sticker and everybody gets together. Can't we all just get along? No, we cannot all just get along. Jesus said, either you're with me or you're against me. There's no cooperation with other faiths.
Right.
Well, I don't feel like that's right. Then he's not Lord. Then he's not your Lord. He's just your friend. You know one of the songs I hate on the radio? Every time it comes on the radio, I turn it off. Jesus, friend of sinners. Every time it comes on the radio, I turn it off. That's not the Bible. That sounds good. He's not a friend of sinners. There's no scripture to validate him being a friend of sinners. Either you're with me or you're against me. His own mama wanted to come see him. No, y'all don't hear it. Jesus' own mama, brothers, and sister wanted to come see him. He sat in a meeting and said, who's my mama? Who's my mother? Who's my brother? Who's my sisters? He says, no, it's those that are sitting right here doing my will.
Right.
He said, I don't know them.
Come on, now. That's right.
See, you got this popular Hollywood Jesus picture. that's not the real Jesus. He said, I didn't come to bring peace.
Right.
He said, I came to bring a sword. I came to bring a sword, and sometimes the sword might be between father and son and mother and daughter and brother and sister. He said, hey, if you're with me, you're with me. If you're not, you're not.
Right.
I ain't trying to be your friend.
That's right.
I warned you, Tamara, I was old school. By old school, I go by the Bible,
right.
Not by what's popular,
right.
Not what I think is relevant.
Right.
I go by the Bible. If the Bible says it, that's what I go by. So if we make Jesus a friend of sinners, then he's friend of the Islam. He's friend of Baha'i. He's friend of Sun Young Moon.
No,
he's friend of all that. He's okay, y'all can all, come on, let's all go hang out. He's not. Oh, God. The other day, I'm almost out of time and I ain't even got to my points yet. I'll finish it next week. Go to Luke 13. One day one evening I was asleep, and it was a Wednesday morning, and the Lord woke me up with this scripture. That ever happened to anybody?
Yes.
You're connected with God, and he'll put a scripture on you, and you went, okay, go to that. I'm like, I don't even know what that scripture is. Lord, let me go find it.
Yeah.
And he woke me up with this scripture here. Luke 13. He said Luke 13, verse 1 is what he gave me, so I knew where he was going here now. Luke 13. There were present at that season some who told him about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answered and said to them, do you suppose that these Galileans were worse sinners than all other Galileans because they suffered such things? He tell you no. In other words, no, they weren't necessarily worse sinners or anything. He said they died because this guy, Pilate, was just messing around. But he said, but unless you repent, what's that going to happen?
You will likewise perish.
Likewise. Is this is Jesus talking? No, but he's a friend of sinners. No, he doesn't care about people what religion you are. There's many ways to God. Is that what Jesus said? No, he said John 14 and 1.
I am the way,
the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And we got big time preachers in the church today saying, well, you know, I believe there's many ways of God. Don't worry about it. Then some of them gotten so fancy, I want to say that. I heard one guy said, well, you know, there aren't many ways to God, but I believe there are many ways to Jesus. Well, what scripture you base that on? When Jesus Christ himself said, no man even comes to me except the Holy Spirit draws him.
Right.
See, we got an issue here, don't we? That we're not yielding to the Lordship, we got a generational problem. That's how we end up with shows, TV shows, with all the church people having their own. They just so happy because somebody put them on TV now. And show all their stupidity because they say, well, the world needs to know how it really is. It ain't really supposed to be like that. Y'all ain't supposed to be fussing and cussing and fighting and throwing down and pastors arguing with each other and people arguing with their wife and they ain't sleeping here and there and, you know, my daughter strung out on weed and stuff. What happened? Ain't no more power. How do we get this far? Because somebody stopped opening their mouth. Somebody stopped uttering sayings of old. They started uttering sayings of new. Entertainment crept in. That's right. It was more entertaining to hear this new kind of, that's new, that's new stuff, boy. That's new stuff right there. I got some new stuff. Nah, the power's in the old sayings.
That's right.
What thus saith the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Y'all seen Luke 13?
Yes.
He said, what about verse 4? Of those, or those 18 on whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them. Do you think that they were worse sinners than all of the men who dwelt in Jerusalem? He said, no, they weren't worse sinners. He said, but unless you repent, you're going to likewise perish. Tell your neighbor, you need to repent. Get it right with God. Now see, see now, if you're saved now, you have repented. If you're born again, you have already gone through that repentance experience. Mm-hmm. But how many understand that even every once in a while you need to go back and repent? Now see your neighbor ain't raising a hand because your neighbor been perfect. They've been perfect. Your neighbor, they've been perfect. They just do everything right. They ain't never messed up. But see, that ain't my testimony. I told you that. I've been saved, but I've blown it here or there. I ain't proud of it. I ain't happy of it. I don't care to talk about it much, but I have. But I'm thankful that when I have messed up, I can go to God and repent and say, Father, I confess my sins to you. You are faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I repent. I receive my forgiveness. I receive my cleansing. I'm going to walk all right with you. Now, God, give me your grace even more and your spirit to help me not go back to my foolishness. Because I don't want to perish. Well, I got saved. Once saved, I'm always saved. Well, let's work with that one. Let's work with that one. Explain the fact you just said that if you sin willfully after you have repented, he said there's no more remission of, there's no more crucifix. There's no more forgiveness. There's no more. If you now, he's not talking about you messing up. He's talking about when you have made this turn.
Yes, sir.
And say, I don't go with that no more. You're not gonna make it to heaven. You're not gonna just make it in. Mm-hmm. You walked away from truth. You were once enlightened. I'm not talking about y'all, because y'all are here listening and receiving for what. I'm talking about those ones. There are people that will hear the word of God, believe it, receive it, accept it, get filled, baptized in the Holy Ghost, speak in tongues, do everything. And what happened, I'm telling you, this book, I don't know how you made this far in this book that I just gave you, Sister Angie. But this, Brother Hagin talks about this lady. She was a pastor's wife, identical situation. Talked about how she served God as pastor's wife, and she was all these great things happening. And then she one day began to get these thoughts from Satan about how beautiful she was. And Satan put these thoughts in, and she began to cast those thoughts down. She cast them down. You know, I know I'm beautiful, but I'm serving God. The devil just kept bringing these thoughts, and she cast down. Bringing thoughts, she cast down. But all of a sudden, one day, she stopped casting down. And these thoughts kept coming. All of a sudden now, these thoughts that she was casting down, all of a sudden she lets them kind of dance around her head a little bit. She started giving these thoughts a little bit of time, a little bit of attention. And before you know it, she started speaking them words. And she took thoughts saying. And she began now to kind of let that thing become a stronghold. Then she started acting out, living it out. Before you know it, she left her husband, left the church, left the ministry, left God, said, I don't want this Jesus Christ anymore. Because see, what the devil was telling her was that you're beautiful and this church thing is holding you back.
Mm. Wow.
Wow. See, if she asked somebody Shante to talk to, they would have told her, girl, you better hush your mouth. You better understand. God beautifies you with salvation. God is the one making you pretty. You better not. He ain't holding you back. But see, she let those thoughts get there, and when those thoughts became a stronghold, all the things she once knew, she turned her back on it completely. Mm. Went this way. Mm. And Brother Hagin said, he asked the Lord, well, you want me to pray for her? He said, well, pray for her for what? Mm. She can't be saved anymore. Because Jesus said, I can't get back on the cross. Mm. I can't get back on the cross. So I'm not talking about somebody that's backslidden. They just, you know, whatever. They just, you know, because it's happened to two of y'all in here at least. You got weak. You just kind of stop going to church. You stop praying, stop fasting. But you never in your heart said, I don't believe in Jesus Christ anymore. You never did that. So you never, right? No, you didn't ever make it that far. You just like, shh. But see, when you reach that point, Jesus said, I can't get back on the cross.
Come on.
I don't even know why I'm here, but. Maybe it's because before we can change a generation, we need to change us. I mean, and become hardline about what we believe. We ought to be ready to give our answers to what is the hope of our calling.
That's right.
Why do you believe what you believe? Do you really believe it? Just church, it ain't enough. No, I believe it. And when I believe it, that dictates my actions, my lifestyle. Everything changes. Hallelujah. Because we're going to give an account, ladies and gentlemen. Praise the Lord. Psalm 78. Let me show you five things real quick. We got I still got time on the clock. Who put that time back on the clock? Amen. I thought I was out of time. Hallelujah. All right, look at Psalm 78. All right, so Asaph says, I'll open my mouth. He says, all the dark sayings of old, things we've heard and known, and our fathers have told us. This is verse 3. Verse 4, he says, we won't hide them from their children, telling to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. Got it? So he says, now watch. I'm going to show you five things he said that will happen when we open our mouths. Look down here at verse 6. Well, let me start at verse 5. Verse 5, rather. He says, for he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel. Testimonies and laws. He says, which he commanded our fathers. Here's the first thing that will happen. One is they will know the testimonies and laws of God. If we open our mouths, the generation today and those will come, that those that are to come, will know the testimonies and the laws of God. Well, why is that important? Because if people don't have God's laws in their hearts, there then are no boundaries or restraints.
Right. They'll do anything.
Y'all gotta catch this here. Any person that does not understand, have a proper understanding of righteousness and justice will have no restraints in their lives. Judges chapter 17, verse 6 says this. In those days, there was no king in Israel or nobody to give law and order. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Isn't that like what we're hearing today? You know, if it feels good, do it. To each his own. Now we're tending towards a nation without any law and order. We're telling people, well, just do, you know, whatever feels good, do it. But you get mad if they break in your house.
What?
Well, they might have felt like breaking in your house. See, you can't have it both ways. See, there has to be some kind of law and order. Now, we need God's law and order because every one of God's laws, they are righteous and just. How many of y'all understand there are some unjust laws on the books in man's eyes? But God's laws, they are righteous and just. Hallelujah. I want you to read Proverbs 29, verse 18. Proverbs 29, verse 18. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It says, where there is no revelation, the people do what? But notice the opposite. But happy is he who keeps the law. So keeping the law is opposite of casting off restraint. But what happens if we don't know God's laws? Isn't it interesting why the devil has done such a superb job of removing the Ten Commandments from our nation? from the fabric of our society, and he's even now gotten Christian preachers to go along with it. Christian preachers are saying, oh, we don't need the Big Ten anymore. Okay, but the Big Ten, the Big Ten is the foundation of all law. I mean, if we don't need the Big Ten, then you can't get mad at murder. If we don't need the Big Ten, don't get mad when some man sleep with your wife. Because you said we don't need the Big Ten, but all, it's all based on the Big Ten. The devil worked to get rid of it, and now he's got the church to go along with it. Because we're under grace now. We don't need the Big Ten. Without the Big Ten, the people cast off restraint. Get that same verse amplified, please. Same verse amplified. Read it with me. Read it with me. Ready? Read. Where there is no vision, no redemptive revelation of God, the people perish. But who? Which includes that a man blessed. So keeping the law brings a blessing. Not restraint. Not restriction. It's a freedom to enjoy the blessing. Glory to God. I'm going to read this same verse, Proverbs 29, verse 18, from the easy to read version. Listen to this. If a nation is not guided by God, the people will lose self-control. But the nation that obeys God's laws, come on. Same verse from the Living Bible. Same verse from the Living Bible. Where there is ignorance of God, is crime running wild?
Yes.
It's because of an ignorance of God. Why? Because people aren't teaching about God's laws or his commandments. We're not telling it. We're not opening our mouths. We're not teaching our children even from young age. You'll tell them stuff like, don't run in that street. Right? Don't run in that street. We won't tell them, don't lie. Don't bear false witness. Do not steal. Do not commit adultery. Honor the Lord your God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. See, this is all part of that. And if we don't do that, there's no restraint. So that's why a kid people can fight and cuss each other out. And don't really have any regret about it, any remorse about it, because we've left the law of God. But I'm praying that in this generation there's still a remnant. And that this remnant will serve him, and it'll be accounted to God for a generation, that God will look at this generation and say, you know what, that was a righteous generation. There were some people who stood up for me in that generation. Woo-wee! Boy, y'all are running up and down the aisles, boy. All right? So what I say, the first thing that happened is they will know the testimonies and laws of God. So when children know, or young people, when adults, we know the laws and testimony of God, we'll have order. You can leave your door unlocked. Hallelujah. You don't have to worry about identity theft. Right? All right. Number two, look at verse 6. That the children that the generation to come might know them. The children who would be born, that they may arise and declare them to their children. So the second thing is that'll happen is that the generation will pass God's testimonies and laws to their children in the next generation. So God, whatever God says is meant to be passed to the next generation. How many of y'all remember the African, the person through African history, particularly West Africa, called the Griot? Yep. Two people. The Griot, G-R-I-O-T. Yep. Griot was a African storytellers. Yep. And you'll find that the storytellers actually, they would tell these stories they'd sit there and tell a story, or they'd make music. In fact, if you look at Wikipedia, it talks about them being praise singers, them being poets, and them being musicians. So the purpose of the singing or the the songs and the poems was meant to tell a story or to pass on stories of the past, to pass on traditions. How many of y'all understand, ever heard the phrase Negro spirituals?
Yes.
Feel y'all old enough to remember, know what Negro spirituals are? Do you know Negro spirituals weren't just music? And they weren't just stories. Many of them were passwords. It was coded messages. Come on, study your African American history. It was coded messages to pass information from slave to slave, from plantation to plantation. So that everybody knew what was going on. Swing low, sweet chariot. Coming to carry me home. That one, they were talking about no angels coming from heaven. The Underground Railroad. This is how. Golly. They were telling stories meant to transfer information. That's why we place a demand, even on our music here in church. We ain't just singing no dumb song like just want to make it to heaven. No, we were trying to transfer the word and get the laws of God and the will of God into your heart. So you can pass these things on. Storytellers tell the law of God. Poets and musicians were designed to tell the law of God. Hallelujah. So he said, this is what happened. If we open our mouths, they will pass, or we will pass God's testimonies and laws to our children and to the next generation. So each generation, as they sing these songs, hallelujah. You sing these lullabies, not just lullabies. They're passing on. They're getting, because, you know, music is how you get information in. Y'all got that? Music is how you get information in. Music is how you get information in. All right? That's how you learned your ABCs. Through the song. Not through a chart. Right? Psalm 103:17 says, but the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. This is Psalm 103:17. On those who fear him and his righteousness to children's children. So God is always concerned about children's children. All right, now let me move quickly to number three. Number three, right there, verse 7. Verse 7, here's the biggest thing out of this whole thing to me. Says that they may set their hope in God. So when we tell of God's goodness and his power and his commandments, people, generations will set their hope in God. People today are trusting in the government. Your hope shouldn't be set in government. Because the government fails. They shut down. They have furloughs. They have corruption. They have paperwork. Make you embarrass yourself. You got to tell all your business just to get their little hand out. Then they put a limit on you and tell you if you get this, you can only make so much money. We'll give you some beans and butter, but you can only make this amount of money. When you put your trust in the government, you have limited yourself. But he said, we will set our hope, or they'll set their hope in God. People trust in that, they trust in education. Come on now, I get a degree, I'm going to make it. Your degree don't mean nothing. It don't amount to a hill of beans. That paper, it's just paper. $20,000, $40,000, $80,000 worth of paper. Y'all don't like this preacher here. This is $80,000 worth of paper. You got to pay for that paper for the next 450 years. 450 years. What it would take you to pay off average student loan debt, 450 years, that you ain't going to see, that your children got to pick up the tab for your paper you got. Pastor, you saying anything wrong with education? No, something wrong with the system. I'll say that for another day. When you set your hope in it, you're setting yourself up for a trap. Setting yourself up for economic traps. Yeah, there's an article I wish I should email everybody called the College Hoax. Because Pastor Kim and I have been laying this whole thing about education for years. Now, we've been talking about education for years and telling people not to get trapped in this whole educational rat race. Uh-huh. We've been saying this for years. Yes. Well, I just happened upon an article this past week from Forbes magazine. Y'all heard of Forbes?
Yes.
Forbes is the foremost financial magazine in the world. And Forbes is telling what we've been preaching. Said it's all a big hoax because education now is it's a business. It's a business. It's not about education. It's about business. So they create all these dummy degrees and all these higher level degrees to get you to think, well, if I get this degree, I'm going to make it. It's a business. And in a business, they're getting poor people because it attracts the poor. They're trying to get poor people to go put all their money that they don't have, so they got to borrow it from predatory lenders to put all that money in their schools so their schools can function and thrive with the allure that you're going to make $1 million more over your lifetime than the person without a degree. Tell that to Bill Gates. Tell that to Warren Buffett. Tell that to the richest men on this planet who don't have degree. Yeah, I can make money. Yeah, but how much debt you got?
Right, it don't even balance out, sir. A quarter of a paycheck going to pay that bill. That's foolishness.
How much debt you got?
Yeah.
With all that student loan. But I gotta better myself.
Get out of bed and go to work. Come on.
See, I've been preaching this, but it was so gratifying to hear Forbes say it. Because now the world is telling on itself. The world is telling on itself. Boy, this is good, boy. The world telling on itself. They're telling people put all this hope in education. They say it's all a farce. They said it's all a hoax. This is their article. It's a hoax.
It's a hoax.
College has become a big business trick. I got a few witnesses. And they talked about in the article, this one guy talked about how you sent your child off to college. They're gonna make it. I'm gonna put up $80,000. They're gonna make it in college. And every time somebody gotta come do your roof or do your lawn, you get mad because you gotta write this big check for the lawn man, a big check for the roof, or a big check for the electrician to redo your house. You mad about that big check you had to write to them. But the roof will make it more money than your son ever will. The electricity will make it more money than your daughter ever will. You mad because you got to pay that. But I want my child to have a degree. It's a scam. See, I know some of y'all, you so daggone smart, you going to disregard everything I'm saying. But hey, at least hear Forbes. He's just a preacher. He's just preaching that stuff. At least hear Forbes.
It's a hoax, man. I'm a witness.
See, but when people have set their hope in that, as opposed to setting their hope in God, watch this. Hebrews 6:19 says, this hope we have is an anchor of the soul. This hope we have, this hope in Christ is an anchor for the soul. So you want to know why people's souls out of whack? Because they don't have a hope anchored in God. And lives and souls, minds, all out of whack, Brother Tony. Man, I don't know, I'm going to make it, man. I'm really going through right now. Well, because you put your hope in that. Fell for the okie doke. Hey, you in good company because a lot of folk have fallen for the okie doke. Come on now. Anybody been okie doke now? Bamboozled. I didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed on me, you know. That's what happened. and then you help you, you get your degree, and then, you know, you're trying to make your money, and then, oh God, I gotta hustle. And so, well, you might need more degree. So I gotta go to school, get more degree, and I gotta get more degree, and I gotta get a degree in that, because I got my degree in that, but then this ain't paying what I wanted to pay, so market change, so now I gotta go to get this degree and that, and oh my God. And can I tell y'all something? That's why I don't want you ever get impressed by all the letters behind somebody's name. Because folk are struggling. All right, let me finish this last two because I gotta go. Psalm number 20, verse 7 and 8 says this. Some trust in chariots and some in horses. That's the world system we're talking about here. The strength of man. But we will remember the name of the Lord our God. They have bowed down and fallen. But we have risen and stand upright. I'm telling you, if you will put your hope in God, while the world's going down, God is bringing you up. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. While they're, this Isaiah 60, verse 1 through 3, while they're in darkness, coming in light. My wife and I, we just have watched this happen right where we are. We remember talking about Mom and Dad Durber. I'm gonna close this down. Mom and Dad Durber talked about how when they moved into the neighborhood, they moved in this gated, exclusive community. How when they moved in, you know, they were very intimidated. You know, they knew God was sending them there, but they were very intimidated because where they moved, everybody, you know, looked like they was, you know, the country club, you know, that kind of And when they got there, they were so intimidated. And the word of the Lord came to them on the inside and said, don't look at that. It's not what you think. He said, they're in trouble. He said, watch. While they're coming down, I'm bringing you up. And they said, they began to watch. And all of a sudden, these houses all go up for sale. Yeah, this is the most exclusive neighborhood in the region. I mean, where you going? In that area, I should say. Where you going? They downsizing. Because they're going, everything's falling apart for them. Because they did all that debt system. They're doing just and they were going down. And Durbers start going up. Boom, boom, boom. God's just raised them up. They were, you know, they came in there with a smoking blazer. They don't have no smoking blazer no more. You know what I mean by smoking blazer? Not a jacket. I'm talking about a Chevy blazer that... You know what I mean? Like, you know, that kind. They don't have it no more. Now they're driving that.
Come on.
And it's funny. My wife and I have watched the same thing. My wife was noting the other day. We're like, all these houses. Now, when we first moved out here, we couldn't find a holiday house for sale. But now all these, every day for sale. Because people don't know. They put their hope in a system that is failing. And don't know how they're going to make it. See, don't you ever get intimidated because somebody come and say, well, I'm a lawyer. I'm a doctor. Don't remove that. Praise God. Praise God, Dr. Debt Master. How you doing, Dr. Debt Master? Hey, you know, praise God for you, but don't get impressed by that. Pastor, we need doctors. I didn't say anything wrong with being a doctor. I didn't say anything wrong with education. But don't put your hope in it. Yeah, don't pay for it. And that right, Joy. Make them pay for it. Look at verse 7 of Psalm, what were words? Psalm 78. Verse 7. When they said to open God, what's going to happen? They will not forget the works. So that's number 4. They will not forget the works of God. All those testimonies that you've told, they won't forget it.
That's right.
If you take time to testify to your children and people around you about what God has done, that's why this testimony is coming. We encourage you to send in more testimonies. Deacon Gershman stood there today and testified about what God has done in our lives. You're not going to forget that.
No.
Time's going to come when you're going to be in trouble You're going to remember him doing this, looking at his bills and then looking and saying, Father. You're going to see that in your head, looking at the bills and then saying, Father. And what are you going to do? You're going to, Father. That's why the Bible talks about in Hebrews 12, it says, seeing as we are compassed about by so great a cloud of witnesses. See, you and I are witnesses of what God has done, but we got to tell it. Tell it. Tell what God has done in your life. Don't hide testimonies. Don't hold things back. Hallelujah. Yeah, tell the truth. Sometimes we got to tell a dirty truth. Man, I was broke. No, I'm serious. I was between checks. You weren't between no check, nothing. You was broke. Tell the truth. Yeah. All right. Look at this last one in verse 7. Go back to verse 7. Psalm 98, verse 7. 78, verse 7. But keep his commandments. And the last thing is that they'll keep God's commandments. They'll keep God's commandments. What happens when you keep God's commandments? He said, the ones who keep my commandments are the ones that love me. The ones who love me are the ones I'll manifest myself to them. God will show up in people's lives if we keep his commandments. That's just how it works, man. He'll do these things, wondrous things. Pastor Kim, the Lord gave her a word Tuesday during the noon prayer. The word of the Lord came to her, and she uttered it out, bubbled it out, where God said, go ahead and just receive your house, your car, all these good things I'm trying to give you, so we can get past that and get to the city. In other words, God was saying, this is little stuff. You getting your house, you getting your car, you getting your manifestation. This is all little stuff. Just going to receive that stuff so we can go ahead and get to this city here. Because people out there in the city need to hear what God has done in your life. You might have to write the book. telling my spiritual dad about his testimony. He said, man, you got to tell it everywhere you go. He said, you're going to tell that story, same story everywhere you go. So I said, I will. I tell him the story about how my wife and I went in our old house when we used to get ready to go out of town. Y'all heard me tell that? Yeah. We used to get ready to go out of town. You know, whenever we're going to take a trip somewhere, I don't care if it was for one day or 10 days, we couldn't just pack the car, you know, like you normally, you pack your car, because our neighbors are watching us. Hey, they about to go out of town. They gonna hit it. So when we pack it like in the cover of night, or like pack like one bag at a time, put in the car and take it. You know, we'd have mom gonna pick us up. Whoever gonna pick us up down the street. Don't come to the door. Pick us up down the street, cause these people know when you leaving your house. That used to happen. That's how they kept breaking into our house. They knew when we was gone. They knew that last time they broke in, they knew we was headed to a Christmas party.
Yep.
They knew. They saw all us pack up in the car.
All dressed up
with food.
Yep.
They knew, boy, them jokers gonna be gone for a minute. Well, the testimony about that is, we ain't gotta do that no more. Wow. We ain't gotta do that no more. We do that, see. But see, if we don't tell the story, man, it's true, boy. It wasn't always like this. Didn't always have a garage.
See?
But we have to tell these things. See, and our children have to know. They sleeping now, but I'll tell them. Tell them sinners to wake up. Wake up. Arise thou that sleepest, and Christ shall give thee light. Let's pray. Let's pray. Did y'all get anything out of this today?
Yeah.
I know it seemed like I might have seemed like I was rambling on a little bit, and I probably was in a couple places, but it was because I was feeling this old school, you know, urging just to lay it down, just talk like a pastor talk. Not to be so methodical on this, you know, just because we need to know the real truth. The nitty gritty. And then let's get with it. Amen. So we will pray God to give us something else next week. God, give us some exciting next week. Praise the Lord. We can shout about it. But if we do this, we'll be able to shout 7 days a week. 7 days a week. Father, thank you today. We praise you. We give you glory. Hallelujah. Thank you for this time. Thank you for this word. Thank you for your laws. Thank you for your commandments, which are true and just, which are righteous. Hallelujah. Your word says in Psalm 112, praise the Lord. Blessed is the man that fears the Lord and delights greatly in his commandments. His seed will be mighty in the earth. The generation of the upright will be blessed. And then you didn't stop there. You said wealth and riches will be in our houses. God, there's blessings attached to us fearing you, serving you, honoring you, and keeping your commandments. God, we're not trying to be like the world. We're not trying to fit in. We're not trying to be in the in crowd. The only crowd we want to be in is a crowd of those who are serving you, living for you, walking uprightly, honoring you, trusting you, setting all of our hope in you. I pray, Father, that today and those on the sound of my voice, everyone who would do what we've heard and received today, that, Father, we'll begin to see a difference not only in our lives, but in our children, and our children's children, and the generation around us. That all those you give us influence over, whether it's people who are on our jobs and we're able to talk to them, all those who are at school and we're able to minister to them, Lord, all those in our neighborhoods and our families and we're able to tell them something, I pray today that you give us holy boldness. Give us boldness to preach your word. We pray even as the Acts church prayed in Acts 4, that God, you give us boldness to preach your word by stretching forth your hand, that signs and miracles and wonders will be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus, that you do such powerful things in our lives that it would give us an audience with people, Lord, that people would begin to hear us and listen to us, because not only do we have words, but there's power backing up our words. And not only do we have our religious beliefs, but Lord, there's power backing up what we believe. Because your kingdom is not in word only, but it's in power. It's in demonstration of the Spirit. I pray that in our lives there'll be power in the demonstration of the Spirit so that people will heed what we say when they see the things even that are done in us, through us, and for us. I speak blessing today over every person in this room, that as we lean ourselves wholly on you, that you'll begin to move in our lives swiftly, that we'll see changes happening in our lives swiftly, Father. As we set our hope in you and not in the world, not in the world system, not in anything of this world, we set our hopes in you, that God, you raise us up so quickly that it'll make the world's head spin. But when they come around, they'll know that you are God. And they'll say, we know that you must be with God and that God must be with you. I thank you for today and I give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And amen. Praise God. Give God a hand if you received the word today.